Now this SQL injection, error based SQL injection, is not only for login, it can also be for any other parameter which is injecting, which is interacting with the database. Okay, now going forward, let's take a new object. So over here we found the email, the email address of the admin user. This is some very good information. We have already copied it. Now what we will do is we'll try to find the password of this user. Okay, so the script started. Alright, so it's getting the password word by word. Sorry, character by character. Okay, so this is what is happening over here. Hi, in this video, we will be attempting to exploit SQL injection. Over here, we will attempt to exploit both an error-based SQL injection as well as a blind SQL injection. We can use the same authentication panel for both error-based SQL injection and blind SQL injection. Now, going forward, firstly, this is our login panel. Alright, so we have the username admin, you have the password as admin. Now, why we have added this extra quote over here is because in SQL query, when you know the SQL query is made, something like select star from users where username is equal to admin and password is equal to admin. This value, right, the admin, the username and password value, it will be wrapped inside double quotes, So it will be something like admin, something like this. So what we will do is when we attempt to, we have to attempt to break this query. So when we give and sync something like a single quote, it will break the query and cause a syntax error. Alright. So that's what we are trying to do to check if the application is really vulnerable to SQL or not. You can do the same to check any parameter if it is vulnerable to SQL injection or not. This is the basic step and it is the most important one of all. So now over here, I'm doing an admin, both username and password, both I have used a single quote over here. So let me try to log in. Okay, so it throws an unusual error because usually when I give it without a single quote and if the username and password is wrong, it will say invalid email or password. But when I give with a single quote, let's see what's happening. It's saying object. So there must be something more fishy about this. So let's inspect this with burp and try to understand this even more better. So let's turn it on and let's hit login. Okay, let's send this to repeater. Alright, so now it's on repeater and the single quote is there. Let me hit go. Okay, so as I expected, an error message has come up. And let's look at the details of the error message. What the error says is, it's an SQLite error, an unrecognized token, blah, blah, blah. Alright, so this is what an error based SQL injection would look like. Over here, you get detailed database error. Now here it says it's an SQLite error. We all know that SQLite is a database. So, RDBMS database. So over here, what we can see is SQLite error, which is very good information for us because from SQLite to SQL to MySQL to PostgreSQL, the databases, you know, the query for every database changes slightly. So it's very good to know the name of the database. If not, also you can find out the what type of databases it is by using the comment symbol. For example, also the quotes, because in some databases they take in double quotes, but over here, double quotes will cause an error, but over here, single quotes is causing an error. Similarly, in some application when you're testing for SQLite, you can use double dash for comments. We know what comment is for. It is used for, normally developers use it to mark some important data or to let them indicate what this data is about and stuff. But in SQL, double dash is mainly used for MySQL and SQLite. double dash plus and a dash is mainly used for MS SQL. So it keeps on changing. So based on the comments also, you'll be able to identify what database it is. Also based on the web application technology. Alright, for example, if you use WAP analyzer over here, WAP analyzer clearly tells that it is PHP application which is running in the background. So PHP is most likely to be linked with an MS SQL, sorry, with an MySQL or a SQLite database. Same thing if you see something like ASP.NET or a Microsoft IIS server, then it will most probably use a Microsoft database like MS SQL. Alright, so that is easy to understand. Next, going forward, we have an SQLite error, which is very good information. Okay. Second up, when we look at the error message deeper, you get the syntax itself. Syntax of the SQL query, which is being sent to the database by the web server. Alright. So let's copy this to understand this even more better. So we'll put it here so that we will know how to break it more easily. Okay. So now this is causing an error. What we have to do is, like as we saw in a previous video, we have to make this return true over here and true over here. Both should return true, then we will get login as some user. Alright, so now let's look at the password first. Injecting into the password is not a good option over here, because as you can see, whatever data we enter is being hashed over here. That means even if we enter an injection, it will be hashed over here. So we are not able to explicitly control the data which is being sent to the application in this parameter, say the password parameter. So it's best to ignore this and not use this as an injection point. But if you go to the admin, whatever we have entered has directly come over here. So this is a good location for SQL injection. Now we don't want the rest of the query to work, alright, since it's causing an error. I mean, since we cannot inject directly to it. So what we will do is, we will use comment symbol and comment the rest out of it. Okay. So now we have admin over here. Next, we have to make this return a true. So let's say we do not know that the username is admin. Let's keep it as A. So we have to make it return true. So when it reads from the database, select star from users where email is equal to A, it will return false. So we have to make it return true. We'll inject our additional statement or 1 equal to 1. Okay. So now what is happening over here is, you know the OR gate, right? So this is false. So when it is false, it will automatically execute the next statement. So when it executes the next statement, what will happen is 0 and 1. This will be true. So true and false is true in terms of OR. So over here, what happens? The database will return saying true. Okay, user exists. So the web application will automatically give you login. Alright. So now over here, there's a small syntax mistake in the SQL query we've made. It is because to understand the importance of balancing the quotes. Because you see these quotes, right? It could be single quote or double quote. It is very important to understand to balance these quotes. So let's inject this to our query. So let me go ahead and do this, most probably. Okay, so now it says invalid email or password, which means we haven't injected it correctly. So let's balance the quote over here, and now hit login. This should work. Okay, it worked and we got the authentication token, which is the cookie for admin at JuShop, this email address. Let's load this email address. It would be pretty helpful for us. Control C and so this is a classic example of error based SQL injection, where if you let's say by mistake you to cause a database error. Surprising. Let's say you cause a database error, and based on the error, you will be able to build your query and bypass the authentication mainly. Now, this SQL injection, error based SQL injection, is not only for login, it can also be for any other parameter which is injecting, which is interacting with the database. Okay, now going forward, let's take a new objective. So over here we found the email, the email address of the admin user. This is some very good information. We have already copied it. Now what we will do is we'll try to find the password of this user. Okay, so now let us just inject email is equal to A, or in, we have to add an additional query to this. In SQL, to add a query, what you have to do is you have to use an union statement. Okay, so union select star from, based on the errors we know what is the table name, users, where where email equal to, inside double quotes, copy this and paste it from here. Oh my gosh, let's paste it over here. This looks correct. Let's send it over. Okay, the query is correctly working. That means our syntax is right, but we are not getting any result. Okay, we are not able to see the password of the user. Okay, this is shocking. I mean, this is little heartbreaking. We are not able to extract. So now what we will do, this is a case of blind SQL injection. You only know if the SQL query is exact, is running correctly or not, but you don't know if, but you're not able to extract additional information from the database. Alright, so you, through blind SQL injection, we will attempt to extract additional data from the database. So now going forward, let's use a feature in MySQL to our advantage. This feature is called as exists. So we have to make this execute. So or exists, and the syntax for that, you will put it inside bracket, exists select star from users where email is equal to, this is okay, and password we don't know, right? So let's ask the database, is the user's password starting with the letter A? So like starting with A, and after that any number of characters are following. This is a wildcard symbol, you can read about it. And if the juice shop's password is starting with A, let's hit go over here. Okay, so there's something wrong with our SQL query. Let's build it up further. Okay, we did not close this. We opened a bracket over here. So we have to close the bracket again properly. So let's close it. So go. Okay, so now it returned an in. But if we do it correctly, it will give us the token. Alright, so we know that the user's password does not start with A. Does it start with B? No. Does it start with C? Okay, so we'll do this with burp intruder. Okay, so then we will A, sorry, B, C, D, sheesh, E, F. Alright, so now this, you can do this even with Python, so it's pretty much easy. So now let's copy this, let's send this to our intruder to make our life easy. So positions is clear, everything we know, we have to inject over here, select this and add. Okay, payload, we copied A to Z, let's paste A to Z over here. Okay, and then and then all we have to do is just start the attack. Okay, so the password is not starting with ABCDEFGHIJK. We can say that based on the status as well as the length. Okay, it has finished. So everything is returning a 401. Let's just double check if our request is correct. And what is the response? No SQL error. That means it's all right. And password like A. And password like F is correct. Okay, so let's add some numbers to this list also. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. Cool. So let's copy this. Ctrl+C and then here paste. We have the numbers also. So now let's start the attack. Okay, so the attack has finished, and if you look at the result, only for zero it has returned a value. Okay, it says the size is different and the response code is different, so based on that we can say that it has worked. Okay, wow, so we have got a token for zero. So the password of this user starts with zero. Okay, so now let's try the second one. Let's try to inject the second parameter. So now positions clear. We know the first one is zero, and the second one we have to keep changing this. So add. So yeah, okay, then payloads. Let's do it here. So payloads, you know the first one is zero and the second one we have to keep changing it. So zero, so add, and then payload is the same list. So let's start the attack. This is without any payload in the beginning, so that is obvious. Okay, so 01 actually worked. Let's try this. So yeah, so 01 is actually the second digit of the admin-jushops password. Alright, so let's close this. Payloads. So 01 and now we don't know what is going to be here. So let's manipulate this parameter. Add. Payload, same thing, start attack, okay. So the third letter is, so the third character is 9. For 9 we get a proper response. Okay, now this is well understood how character by character we can go ahead and get the entire password. Now doing this manually is time taking, so in this case what we have to do is always try to automate. For that I have written a Python script. I will explain that to you. Okay, so in Python, how we start off, this is my Python script for the bind SQL injection. So how we start off is, firstly we import requests. So these are what these import statements are, they are libraries. Basically, let's say now you have to write a Python code to send a web application request and then receive the response and stuff and all that. It's going to be time taking, right? So through libraries, these are codes which are already written by some other person. You only have to know what is the library name. You can Google this anytime. So for sending web application requests and receiving response, I know that the library name is requests. Okay, so I'm just importing that library. Please give me your data, I'm asking. And the second thing is strings. Okay, so this is also important because when we are dealing with string data, but in this case we are not ideally not dealing with any strings over here, so we can remove this. Now next up what we have is a variable. A, this can be any variable, a b c d f g or your name or EASYCYBERSEC or anything like that. And now these are the list of characters that I want to inject and check the password. It is most probable, right, the password will be within small letters and then capital letters or numbers and some special characters. Now to keep it simple, I've added just one special character, or you can go ahead and add all the special characters. Then B is nothing, blank, I've left it empty. I will tell you why. Next one is while loop. When you give a while true, the program underneath that while loop will keep on executing. It will just not stop. So we need this program to keep on running, keep on sending multiple requests, every request with one increment. Alright, so for that we have not restricted the times it should run. So we've given it while true. And then for I in range, length of A. Length of A is the length of all this together. It is because it has to keep checking one by one, right? So what will happen here is when you give this code, I over here is A initially. So it will check, send this request for A, and then it will send this request for B until it reaches the dollar symbol. All right. So for that only we use this length of A, which means how much ever length there is, that many times it will keep sending the request. Okay. And then R is just a variable to store the response of the request. So what I'm doing is requests. This is the library name. All right. So I'm doing a post request. Okay. And the post request is to user.login. And then this is my test server. And then the content I'm sending is the SQL injection. So I'm sending JSON to it. So JSON email. All right. So this is all what you know. So we know the email of the user. And then password, this is the tricky part where you have to understand. And password is like plus B. Okay, so first time what will happen is, I told you B is blank, right? There's no characters over here. So over here a blank character will be. And then A of I. So what is A over here? A is this string. So what is A over I over here? 0. It starts with 0 and goes up to the length of this string. So what will happen is A of 0 will come there first. Alright, so A of 0 will be here. So what is A of 0? It is the letter A. And then A of 1 is B. And then A of 2 is C. Alright, so until here it will keep on looping. So this is what is happening over here. And then these are the rest of the statement which we've commented out, so it does not matter. Those are SQL comments, not Python comments. And then if r dot status code is equal to 200. So what we say is that we know that when we give a valid when we get a valid response, we get a 200 okay over here. Okay, so then we are saying if r dot status is equal to 200, b in add to b the a of I, string of a of I. That means with whatever you injected and you got a successful response, show that to b, add that to b, and then print b. So if you did not get anything, if you did not get status code 200, just continue the loop until you get it. Alright, so now let's run this program. So Python SQL script, let's hit run. Okay, so the script started. Alright, so it's getting the password word by word. Sorry, character by character. Okay, so this is what is happening over here. Okay, so now this has stopped. Alright, so we have got something about the this value is the response for the password of the user admin@juiceshop.com. Okay, email is that, password is this. Let's copy this. Let's paste it here. So this is the email and this is the password. Let's see if this is working. Go to burp. Turn this off for now. Then let's paste this in the application. Let's see, and over here. Okay, so let's sign in. Okay. It says invalid email or password. Looking at the password, we understand that, okay, this could be hashed. There is a probability that this could be hashed. So let's try to identify if this is really hashed. So, hash identifier online. Let's try to identify the hash online. Okay, online field hash identifier. Let's put in our hash over here and submit. Okay, so it says yes, this could be a hash, and the hash could be, see the first value which is always reflected, MD5 hash. This is some very good information for us. We also know that MD5 is easy to crack, and then let's do something. Let's try to crack the hash. So crack hash online. Crack station. This is a very good site for cracking hashes. Okay, so let's put our hash over here and try to crack the hash. Okay, so wonderful. Our hash has been cracked. Its type is MD5, and the result says the password is admin123. Alright, now these online hash crackers are not always reliable. There are two important tools you can use for this. It's called as, one is called as John the Ripper, and the second thing is called as Hashcat. You can try both out. Very easy to use. John is very, very easy to use. So now it says the result is, let's copy this and try to log in JuiceShop with this password. Login. Wonderful. We've logged in. Alright. You can also try this out with a different user. For example, let's, we have an user called a at b.com and his password is password. It has logged in. Now let's see if this tool is getting the password of this user. So let's just change this to a@b.com and that's all. Nothing else is required. No other changes are required. Let's run this script. Okay, slowly fetching data. Okay, so now it has probably finished running. So let's copy this, go back to our crack station. Let's paste it over here. Okay, so wow, it has cracked again. We've got the result. Okay, if you try any complex password, it is most likely not going to work. Because this crack station does not have complex passwords. So that's why it is always advised to use a complex password. Thank you.